Welcome to the Next Level Podcast. I am your host, Danielle Rocco. And today with me is a man that just fills my heart for multiple years, the one and only Jeffery Combs. How are you today?
I am outstanding. And this is a double pleasure. I had the privilege of spending quality time with you Saturday in New Hampshire. So it is my honor to be on your podcast. I also want to congratulate you on what I see you really delivering for men and women across the United States. This content is very valuable, and to be asked to contribute it is a true honor.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So for those of you that don't know, I met Jeffery, gosh, probably what, 3 years ago now? 2015, I think it was, 15, 16?
4 years, going on four years.
Oh my gosh, how time flies. I met him at an event that he was hosting in Boston, and I walked in, I listened to him a couple times on his Facebook. Was it a Facebook show? What were
you
doing?
Yes, it was a Facebook.
Then? Yeah, okay. And I knew, I walked in, I was like, I am hiring this man to be my business coach, to mentor me and lead me into my greatness. And sure enough, I walked in, and that's exactly what I did that day.
I remember it like yesterday.
Yeah, it was good. It was the start of a great relationship. But tell me, tell everybody a little bit about you. I know you very personally, very well. I follow you. You have changed, assisted me in changing so much of my mindset, how I think, what I attract. But tell the world in your own words, you know, who you are and why you do what you do.
All right, I'd be honored to do that. Well, first of all, I'm a Midwestern boy from right outside of Omaha, Nebraska. I actually grew up in the Iowa side of Omaha, Nebraska, and had aspirations to move to Los Angeles. I was a high school athlete. I was a good student, got a college degree. But on that journey, I also encountered addictions. And I spent from 18 to 31 wrestling with my addictions. Alcohol was my drug of choice, but I also was a drug addict, was promiscuous, was overwhelmed, in control, and spent a lot of my time not feeling good about myself. Spent a lot of my time in apathy, shame, and guilt over about a 14-year period to where eventually it led me to rock bottom. And I hit one of those bottoms that was really rock bottom, and I had two choices. I had either get sober or die as an addict. I chose getting sober, and I've been sober for 31 years now. And that sobriety really led me back, got me back on path of my dreams. And over about an 8-year period, I was able to, in business, started to become skilled at owning businesses after trials and tribulations, and eventually found myself starting my now company, Golden Mastermind Seminars. I'm the author of 5 books. I've coached 12,000 clients, 60,000 hours one-on-one. And I really found my calling in that process of being able to assist people, not to inspire them, not to motivate them, not to show them how to be positive, but my real skill became assisting people to understand the cause that creates the effect of why they do what they do. I specialize in the neuroscience of the brain that's addicted and how to assist people to understand that if you're not one with yourself, then you'll be chasing shiny objects, you'll be getting overwhelmed, you'll be taking on more than you can handle, enabling, over-obligating, that virtually will lead you to a disappointed state. Now, as you start to really understand why you do what you do, then you can do what you're doing. That's inspiring others while being inspired yourself. And that is really what I assist people to understand. I don't help them find their greatness. That's their responsibility. I assist people understand the cause that creates the effect, that creates a neurochemical response that keeps them doing what they do.
He's got that, like, that brain side of it that I love so much. So this is where, you know, when I met him, I was a shell of who I was today. I was stuck in the victim and being a victim of my car accident, being a victim, feeling like I was a teenage, I'm never going to be anything more than a teenage mom. What else was I being?
You had potential though. You had a lot of potential. So, I mean, when you walked in the room, I knew you were hiring me. It was one of those innate situations. It wasn't like, oh, I'm going to persuade her, talk her into it. You walked up and hired me. I knew that was going to happen. I knew that you were the most likely person in the room. You were, when you say it's shell of yourself, You were in potential, though. You weren't really at rock bottom. You were coming off of a car wreck. You'd had a lot of traumas that happened to you as a child that you really didn't understand yet. I assisted you to make more peace with that. And then I watched you really step into your power. Like I said, greatness is your term. My term is you really stepped into consciousness and power. And now you've become an influencer because you began to influence yourself that you weren't a victim. And once you can move into that state, now the rest is capable. The rest is possibility. That's right. That's where I saw you were in capable possibility, but required just a little bit of guidance. And then now you're one of my students that's experiencing quantum leap. That means some greater than whole of parts, where 2 + 2 = 15. So I have a little whiteboard right here. 2 + 2 = 16. It looks like this. 2 + 2 = 16. So that is a quantum leap. That is some greater than whole of part. Now, here's something that's very interesting, Danielle. In today's world, I mean, you have become what is called, this is only my esteemed opinion, you've become a social influencer. Now, this is a really unique and cool skill that you're monetizing, and there's other people that are doing it. In the old days of free enterprise and business, like even 5-10 years ago, you didn't really own a business. You didn't have business skills. Well, in today's world, you can become an influencer and people can begin to follow you. And then in that space, you go, whoa, I mean, I have influence. You can really learn how to monetize influence, and you don't have to have a lot of business skills. And I'm not saying it's easy, but I'm also telling you it's possible, and you are representing that because you're attracting to your reality quality, like-minded millionaires and whatever that even means, but you're attracting people of influence who are hiring you. And they're finding your influence. They don't care about your success. They don't care about your past. They care if you can influence them, and that's what you're becoming. Mm-hmm.
Yes. They want results. People want results. They don't care how they get them. They just want them. They want to show up and have what have something that you can offer. So this is how I feel for everybody, what my interpretation of what Jeff does. I think he's brilliant. He's very humble. He will never, maybe he will say he's brilliant. I don't know, but is that when people say, this happens a lot, like, oh, he's going to make you cry. Well, people say that to me also. Well, she's going to make you cry. I said, no. What I feel like, what you did for me was you didn't let me sit in my BS. You didn't let me stay in the lies that I was telling myself, the stories that I was telling myself. You assisted me in seeing what they were. Now, within seeing them, if that makes some people cry because they're like, whoa, what have I been doing all this time? Who am I actually? And then, or who was I? Not who they were, but what's the word I'm looking for? Who were they becoming? Who were they acting in? Those are things that internalize what I believe makes people cry, because they're having to now face their self in a mirror.
And you're becoming skilled at it.
Yes. And so if that is when you're looking for a coach, and this is what I tell people, when you're looking for a coach, you want someone who's going to pull that out of you. You don't need someone to pet you and tell you you're doing great and you're living this life and you're this victim and you are what you are because of your, society and things that you've lived in. You need that person that is going to look at you and say, no, why are you thinking that? You know the answer, and not accept, I don't know, I'm not sure. Like, how many times I love how you say, how many times you hear, I don't know why I do what I do, or I live a perfect life. I had a perfect childhood. Probably every person you coach, correct?
I do. A lot of the people I coach are stuck emotionally. They don't know why they do what they do. And so there's two different energies in that space. There's repression and there's suppression. Repression are the feelings that we don't remember. We tell ourselves we don't know. And so these are the people that will say, my childhood was a blur. Well, I'll go, well, where'd you go to grade school? And they'll go, well, William McKinley. So your childhood wasn't a blur. Who's your third grade teacher? Someone will actually remember. Name a student that you went in your fifth grade. So the childhood wasn't blurred. That's an embellished, overstated way not to be clear on why you do what you do. That's repression. Those are the events that we forget, we press down. suppression are the events that we continue to sabotage ourselves over and over. We eat the cheesecake when we say we're not going to eat anything sweet. We go to happy hour when we're just going to go check out the scene, but we have a drink and one leads to 15. This is what suppression is, or the mistakes we make over and over. We tell ourselves we know better, but we really don't. And so those are the feelings we hold on to that we perpetuate over and over. So as a coach, I assist people have a better understanding of why they do what they do. How do I is a very overrated situation. That's the mechanics which are out there. But right in here, if you don't understand, if you can't break a behavior you've been conditioned to behave in, then you'll relapse frequently and then you'll be disappointed. That is what I'm skilled at assisting people with, are the events that shape their feelings. If you can't separate your feelings from an event, then you're addicted to it. And you'll create situations, attract people, date, marry, get hired by perpetrators, violators, people who are going to be in conflict with you to fulfill these feelings. And then if you feel victimized, you've become the victim. And then that will fulfill the feelings that you hold on to. I'm in recovery of this. This isn't like something I was born with, the silver spoon. I mean, I was born into what many people would say is a good childhood. Well, your childhood is your childhood, and it's your responsibility to understand why you do what you do. If you don't understand it, then you're in denial. And if you're in denial, you're going to relapse frequently over and over because it's what's familiar. Mm-hmm. And changing isn't hard. Changing is changing. But if your communication style goes, that's going to be hard, that's going to be difficult, then you've already created a counterforce that you have to be in opposition with. So that's what many people do, is they can't find someone to be in conflict with. They'll be in conflict with themselves so they can criticize themselves. And that's what I assist people understand, why they do what they do.
Yeah. And I love how you put, people think addiction is just like drugs, alcohol, sex, like these things. They have zero comprehension that you're addicted to a set of feelings, like you spoke on.
Set of emotions.
And so until people make that connection, that is an addictive personality, they're going to be stuck in what it is, because nobody wants to be an addict, but every single person is an addict. They're just not willing to see it. It's the same thing like when an alcoholic's not willing to see they're an alcoholic.
Danielle, you've seen me do this before. You've seen me at an event. I'll ask someone a question. They cross their legs. Well, they don't understand. They just relapse. Now, I had a woman who could not grasp this even today. And she eventually understood it. So that means that I ask a woman a question, and before she even reacts, her body's running her brain. So she crosses her leg, and then her body's in fight or flight. So she's recreating a memory, and she's using me as her metaphor to relapse back into a set of feelings, because what her brain is saying is, I'm in trouble. Mm-hmm. I'm on the spotlight. I'm going to make a mistake. So she's like, oh. And then her first answer out of her mouth is, And then she tells a story unrelated to the question because she didn't hear it, because her body checked out once I called her name, and she was in fight or flight. This is epidemic. People do this everywhere because they don't understand why they do what they do. Now, once you understand, once you're aware, then you can separate your feelings and the events, and then you're not the mind-body connection to the events that perpetuate your emotions of anxiety, fear, and doubt.
I want to take that, the mind-body connection. You said that over and over again. I've listened to it for 4 years, and it took me the longest time to actually be able to process that and fully understand it. You know, I understood parts of it and I got it, but it took a while. So when I'm saying this because I want people to hear those words, they're going to hear and be like, oh yeah, I got it. I get that. No, you don't, because watch right. How many times you do exactly what he just said you did. It's not understanding it. You're understanding just like the three different words.
I was introduced to it early in my career through Louise Hay. I started reading her book, You Can Heal Your Life. The book was actually handed to me my last year of being an addict, and I never even picked it up. I'm like, yeah, right, this is great. And so I just laid it on a shelf. And when I got clean and sober, I started to actualize the book. And the book was written in 1986, thereabout. And in 88, I started to use it. And that's where I first started to understand mind-body connections. Now, where it really clicked for me, in the back of that book, it'll have a like a dis-ease of the body. So I was born with asthma, And I looked it up, and in a child, it means a child that didn't want to be here. Well, I was an accident, and then it all just clicked for me. Now, that wasn't some like spiritual breakthrough. I mean, it was, but it, I started to understand it. And then over the next 32 years, I embody it. I live it. I understand. If you have a sinus headache, it's not because of the pollen. It's not because of it's hay fever time. It's you want to look at who you're holding on to that's close to you. Because a sinus headache, that is the mind-body connection to it. If you have a thyroid condition, well, that there's more to it than that. If you constantly have gut issues, I mean, what do you have challenges digesting? I mean, if you have irritable bowel syndrome, I mean, what is it that you can't eliminate? These are the situations that you want to start to take a good look at, why I do what I do. But if you're not willing to do that and you want to be a hardaholic, then you'll just stay emotionally addicted to a set of feelings.
And you will pay and you will pay and you will pay for all these like woo-woo courses and books and do nothing about them. Just spend
or
a lot of money.
You'll end up in an intervention and your family will put you in a treatment center. They'll force you into something that you're not ready to accept, and then you'll relapse the first week out.
So there you go. That is it. And we have to, Jeff is a very, very, very busy man. So I have to say thank you so much for taking time out to share with the world your brilliance, because you assisted me tremendously in finding who I am, understanding things that were back here that I just didn't have anybody in my life to bring to the front so that I can now live into, you know, my own brilliance. And he's got an amazing sense of fashion. So we have a special connection that way. He gets me. He gets my vibe. He gets my fashion vibe. But how can the world follow you? How can they, if they want to work with you, how can they do that? Please share with us.
I will do that. But you're talking about cowboy chic, right? Cowboy swag. So like, you know, Danielle, I have to show you this sometime, but I have my first three pair of cowboy boots from when I was like 2 years old, 3 years old, and 5 years old in my house. I'll take a picture and send them to you sometime. So,
I want to see that.
Anyone that's watching this content, once again, thank you, Danielle, for having me here. But if you're receiving this content, you want to contact me. I offer free 20-minute coaching sessions for people who want to explore the possibility of hiring me to be their coach. You can contact me on Facebook. You can contact me on Instagram, LinkedIn. It's Jeffery with an E-R-Y, J-E-F-F-E-R-Y, C-O-M-B-S. You can send me a message. I will return your message personally. It's not something my staff handles. So you can find me on Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and I look forward to being able to connect with you. Danielle, thank you for having me on your Zoom call today. You're an exceptional human being, a great friend, and someone I highly endorse as an influencer.
Oh, thank you so much. And everybody out there, I will put all those links in the comments, and I will see you on the other side.